Thank you. So, hi everyone. It is my pleasure to introduce Slavica Jonic, who is a research director at the Institute of Mineralogy, Material Physics and Cosmochemistry at Sorbonne University. Before this, she did her PhD at EPFL, and before that, she studied at the University of Belgrade. She was one of the first to get interested in continuous heterogeneity in cryo-EM reconstruction. And today she will present some developments and applications from our group, combining image processing, molecular dynamics, and artificial intelligence.
So thank you for this introduction. I think Eve should play my video. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Slavica Jonic. I work at Sorbonne University in Paris. Thanks to the organizers for inviting me to speak today about our work on method development for cryolithography studies of continuous conformation variability of biomolecular complexes in vitro and in situ. These methods combine image analysis, dynamic simulation, and deep learning. Biological complexes are flexible. They change their shapes in order to accomplish biological functions. The changes are gradual with many intermediate states. In our work, we focus on this kind of conformation changes that we refer to as continuous conformation changes, and we develop methods to determine full conformational space without using discrete classification methods. To model conformation, we use normal analysis, which simulates dynamics by linear combination of independent harmonic oscillator types of movements. Low frequency motions describe collective motions, such as change of the shape, and high frequency motions, more localized motions that correspond to change of the bond angles and lengths. Normal analysis can be obtained using an atomic structure or an EM map. If you have an EM map, then you need to obtain a coarse grain model, and for this you can use our method that converts density into 3D Gaussian functions that we call atoms that are then used to compute normal modes. Use Ethereum's lossy network, in which atoms or pseudo-atoms are connected with lossy springs, but only those that are close to each other. And how close they can be is determined by the free parameter R, is called radius of interaction. This is a potential energy function. This is the distance between two atoms, A and B, in the initial conformation, that is assumed to be at the energy minimum, and this is this between the same two atoms in the displaced conformation. Normals are computed through a harmonic approximation of the potential around the minimum energy conformation. To get a harmonic approximation of the potential, we need to diagonalize the Hessian. This matrix of second derivatives of the potential, and through this solution of an eigenvalue problem, we obtain normal modes as eigenvectors of matrix H, that are the cons of this matrix A, and frequency square are eigenvalues of the matrix H. They are the elements of the matrix L. The initial model is can be then displaced using a combination of normal modes A, and the coefficients of this linear combination are called normal amplitudes. They are unknown and cannot be obtained through normal analysis. We obtain them by correlating these models with EM data. We don't use the first six modes that are related to rigid body moments. We start from mode 7. And in our model, normal amplitudes don't have physical units. I will first present our methods for in vitro single particle cryolithography studies. I'll start by introducing the heterogeneity problems we have with this kind of data. Ideally, in the maps, we have many complexes at different random orientations. and positions, and they have identical combinations. This leads to high resolution 3D reconstruction of the complex. In practice, we don't have only heterogeneity of orientation, but also heterogeneity of conformations. And when the conformation changes are continuous, with many intermediate states that are uncountable, this is very difficult to distinguish between the different orientations and conformations from noisy images. And we developed the method that we called HEMNA, this stands for hybrid resolution microscopy normal mode analysis. And here is an example how it works with an input EMAP and set of images. The EMAP is converted into pseudo-atoms, and amounts are computed, and we select a subset of normals with lowest frequency and most high selectivity. And then we use the combination, of these modes with the amplitude Q to deform the pseudo-atomic structure, and then for each single particular image independently, compare this image with projections of the deformed model, and simultaneously find conformational, orientational, and translational parameters. The conventional parameters are normal amplitudes, which are then projected into low dimensional space. This is called conventional space or landscape. In this space, points are images, and cross points are close conformation, similar conformations. The distant points are different conformations. So we don't use any discrete classifications in our approach, but the conformation space allows grouping, interactive grouping of images with similar conformations, and obtains 3D reconstruction, because for each point we have 3 order angles and 2 in-plane shifts. Beside M normal mode amplitudes, also this space allows, without 3D reconstructing, to obtain animated trajectories by displacing the reference structure along different directions. The HEMNA software is open source. It is available as part of our continuous flight plan of SIPM 3. It allows perform all steps of this methodology. We have extended this method recently to analyze subtomograms, so 3D data obtained by cryolithium tomography, which allows in situ studies of conventional variability. The challenges of analyzing cryolithium tomography data are following. First is the missing wedge, which is due to the limited tilt angle in the rhizome microscope. So the sample is tilted, usually between minus 60 and 60 degrees, not between minus 90 and 90 degrees, before the volume can be reconstructed. But this corresponds to a missing data region in the Fourier space. And this produces deformations of the complex at the level of 3D reconstruction in real space. Another problem is a low signal-to-noise ratio. The sample in the cryolithium tomography is exposed to a much lower electro dose than in single particle analysis, so it contains more noise. This is due to the fact that it's the same sample that is imaged many times because it is tilted. And for each tilt, an image is taken. And then the sample accumulates the electro dose, so we need to keep this radiation low, meaning we obtain the low signal to noise ratio. And additional problem is the gravity cell environment. And here you see the nucleosomes in a very compact region of the cell in embryonic fly brain. The classical approach to increase signal and correct for mismatch is subtomogram averaging. That is based on rigid body alignment and classification, and it's suitable to discrete conformational heterogeneity. only. The subdomains that are excised from a tomogram are aligned, usually rich but aligned. And this actually makes that the missing wedge appears at different orientations. And when we average all these subdomains, we obtain an average with a better centralization and with attenuated missing wedge. We have developed the method that is called Hamlet 3D that analyzes subdomograms using one reference 3D model. This can be atomic model again or an EMAP, or it can be also a subdomogram average. You can obtain from this a set of subdomograms by classical rich body alignment and classification. And then we elastically deform the reference using normal modes and compare with each of the subdomograms. We analyze individual subdomograms. And for each of them, we obtain three order angles, three translations, and normal amplitudes that are then, these normal amplitudes are projected into low dimensional space. And in this space, points are subdomograms, and closed points correspond to closed conformations. And those that are distant to different conformations. As with Hamlet, we can interactively group subdomograms with similar conformation, obtain new subdomogram ridges. Or we can animate the 3D reference along slight directions and obtain movies. We use this Hamlet 3D method in cooperation with Angelo Forestier and Michael Esso from LPS, ORSA, and IGBMC education, respectively, to analyze cryo-electron tomography in situ data from quasars. Some previous studies showed by simulation that nucleosome adopts three types of motions: gapping, opening, and breathing. Our collaborators obtained a global subdomogram average from 650 subdomograms using classical subdomogram averaging, and we used this model to as a reference for our Hamlet 3D approach. Here is four views of this model. The method resulted in this conventional space for which we obtained four subdomogram averages from the most dense regions. And here you see four views of this, each of these four subdomogram averages. They show different degrees of gapping and opening of the and breathing of the nucleosome. So we use this global average as three reference for analyzing our subdomograms individually, and these demonstrations here only for comparison purposes. We also obtain movies along two directions. D1 is showing different degrees of breathing, and D2 different degrees of gapping. Hamlet 3D software is also open source. It is available as part of continuous deployment in Sapient 3. Also, it allows all steps of the method to be done. We are providing automated tests of both approaches, Hamlet and Hamlet 3D. We test data that are automatically downloaded, and the full protocol can be tested automatically. Here I'm presenting the most recent work on speeding up the determination of the commercial space by combining Hamlet with deep learning, which we plan later to also extend to Hamlet 3D. The idea is the following. A small data set of images, like 20,000 images, are first analyzed with Hamlet using a reference model, and Hamlet estimates the orientations, shapes, and normal damages for this small data set. Then they are used to train our neural network to learn the mapping between images and the Hamlet estimated parameters. And then the trained network is used to predict all parameters, meaning orientation, shapes, and normal damages for a large set of images, like 1 million images that have not been used for training. for training. In this sense, we use convolutional neural network for regression learning to learn rigid body elastic learning parameters obtained by HEMNA. There is a ResNet 34 model. And here's how we combine HEMNA with this ResNet model. We started first to by simplifying the problem to learn and predict null mode amplitudes only. Here are the results of our test with synthetic data. We generated around 20,000 images of adenylate kinase chain A, the images of size 256 square pixels. They have noise, and once we apply the contrast refraction of the microscope, they have been generated in random projection direction with random in-plane angles and shifts, and random amplitudes of normal modes, 7 to 9 were used. So we arbitrarily selected the first three modes for this, and we use this kind of depends of between the normal modes along the three, between the normal mode amplitudes between the three along the three modes, in order to be able to visually inspect quickly the quality of our prediction. R is a random uniform number between 0 and 1. And the range of the amplitudes is four ranges 400, so the minimum is -200 and +200. The error of prediction respect to the ground rules, the normal mode amplitudes is 20, so this is the average of all three normal modes, which in terms of root mean square deviation between undisplaced and displaced reference is below 1 angstrom. We use 14,000 images for training and 2,000 for validation, another set of 2,000 for prediction. Here is how the results look like visually. In black, you see ground truth normal amplitudes, blue are HEMNA estimated amplitudes, and red are neural network predicted amplitudes. And C1 to 4 are for arbitrarily chosen confirmation of this path that are here shown, so that you see the combination of different motions along the three used normal modes, and each row is another view. Then we later used all parameters, normal numbers, validation, translation for training and prediction. And this, when we include translations and orientations, we obtain the mean prediction error of 0.3 pixel in shift in x and y direction for shifts, and the angular distance between the predicted and ground truth angles is around 3 degrees with standard deviation 1.4. Then we try to reduce these errors by reducing the image size from 256 to 128 square pixels with a bypass filtering, which reduced the error for null mode amplitudes prediction from 20 to 9. The shift prediction remained in the same range, and the hour distance was a little bit, the angles were predicted a little bit worse, less good. So the angle distance increased by 1 degree. Standard deviation also for the angles 1 degree. So the idea now is to combine these results for actually the best trained model for normal mode amplitudes, which is the one that we use with small size images, 128 pixel square, and the best trained model for translations and orientations, which means for original size images, meaning 256 square pixel, and then we are going to predict all parameters, normal mode amplitudes, translation and rotations for a large set of data and then compute the reconstructions from it. Here we give for this experiment that uses three nanomods comparison of processing times for him alone and then neural network training and inference on different devices. For HEMNA, we use here 160 Intel CPU cores at 2.6 gigahertz, and for training of neural nets, we use four NVIDIA V100 GPUs with 5,000 CUDA cores, and the inference was done with only one of these four GPUs. The processing of 1 million of images with HEMNA alone would take 800 hours on this device. And now the combination of HEMNA plus neural network would take for this size of images, that is a large image, in total 48 hours for estimating parameters with HEMNA for 20,000 images, neural network training with this set, and prediction 1 million images. More mods we use, longer time it would need. Inclusion. I present two methods that are available in continuous deployment of Sapien 3 that allow the analysis of continuous commercial variability in vitro. This is HEMNA, and in situ, this is HEMNA 3D. They simultaneously obtain normal mode amplitudes, orientations, and shifts for each image or subtomogram. So images and subtomograms are analyzed in parallel, independently from each other. These methods can be combined with discrete classification methods for more extensive analysis of commercial variability after the classification. I present to you a work in progress on combining HEMNA with deep learning for faster convention space determination. And we plan to use similar to deep learning approach for HEMNA 3D later. With this, I want to thank my PhD students, Mohamed Harsani, who works on tomography approaches, and Iris Hamidush on deep learning, our external collaborators and funding agencies. And thanks to you for your attention. So I'm ready to take your questions.
So thank you very much, Slavica, for the very nice and very clear presentation. So we have already one question from Sergey.
Hi, Slavica. Thank you very much for the presentation. So you may expect my question, can you learn these normal modes? Can you do something? For example, can you learn can you learn the Hessian matrix, or can you learn the spring constants, or I don't know. So you may try learning the Hessian and then applying the NMA, or you may try learning this decomposition from scratch.
Why would I do this? I mean, it's just enough to learn amplitudes.
Well, if you are on with the directions, then these amplitudes wouldn't help.
If we are wrong with direction, we should recalculate the normal modes. That's where you are definitely right. It's something that we haven't tried so far. Because we didn't have time, and this requires some more interesting data sets. But we will probably try it in the future, you know, how you can resume starting from new normal modes after some time, you know, you played with one direction. Yeah, we have this kind of projects planned, but yeah. So that's one possibility to overcome the problem.
Okay, so basically the question was, can you not only train the amplitudes but also the directions? So okay,
It depends what, because you're speaking here about deep learning, right?
Yes.
When you say, okay, this is our first attempt to learn anything from this kind of images. So for the moment, we started with what we already have done with HENA, which means we start from data images, and then we estimate amplitudes, because this is something that we have proved that it works. We are still in the very beginning of deep learning, in the sense that, yeah, this is the proof of the concept, actually, that they have shown. It was not easy at all to, first of all, select which neural network to use. We tried several different models. Then how to learn these amplitudes, you know, with high accuracy, and very recently, actually, we managed to learn the angles and shifts. Actually, angles were very problematic. So I would say even more than amplitudes, angles, rotations are very problematic because you have three other angles. Because you have here full variability, you know, in angles, translations, and amplitudes. So now about learning, like this part with deep learning, learning directions, as you say, Hessian matrix or normal modes. It's something that we may think about later, but for the moment we don't have man or woman power. And computer power, you know, funding to do this kind of tests. But yeah, it's a good idea.
No, it's demanding. May I ask you another question? Elodie?
Yes.
So another question is, if we look at the progress of the CryoDragon model, they have started initially in their preprint with OSAR predicting orientations using deep learning, but they ended up in their final implementation as predicting only the latent space, meaning that the normal mode decomposition, and taking the orientation from I don't remember which piece
from
of software.
Classical image processing.
Exactly,
actually,
yes.
I read their paper some time ago. I don't remember anymore all the details, but basic points I remember very well. So they, of course, they start from classical image processing, like Relion, I think, or CrossSpark, whatever. So they get some classes, you know, they perform some image classification. And when you do classification, because it's you do some refinement with some model that you know, you're refining during the iterations, you get at the end the orientations and translations, you know, at the end of this process for each of the images. So they started with the orientations and translation found after this, let's say, conformation analysis with CrossSpark. You know, they already have a kind of an idea and a very clear, I mean, very close rotations and translations. And then they are just predicting, as you say, the conformation starting from already found angles and translation with something else. I suspect that they had difficulty. I mean, I guess that they will work on this. I didn't follow their work, so I don't know if they have ever tried to predict rotations and translations. I suppose it is difficult. And, you know, because they are doing unsupervised learning, so maybe they find a way how to do it. But for the moment, yes, they start with something that is already very, very important information, you know, for the shape, for the reconstruction.
According to my understanding of their preprints, because I've read the preprint and then the published paper, they tried to predict it using deep learning, but then they rolled back to the classical approach.
Unfortunately, I didn't have the preprint. Are you mean the one that is on archive?
There is BioArchive and there is Nature publication, so you may compare them.
But so they have two different things.
Very different, yes.
Ah, okay, so I read actually the Nature paper, not the one on archive. I didn't have a look, but I will check if you say that there is something about rotation. So I was not aware. So I don't know what was the problem, if that was maybe not that good or.
It seems maybe it was too complex to estimate it using deep learning, I don't know.
Yeah, so I think good thing about this approach is that yes, we already have, yes, it's supervised. It's not unsupervised. We are starting with the model, but I think if you get the model and once you get, as I said, rotations and translations from cross park, reliant on whatever, you already have a first model, you know, because this conventional heterogeneity, yes, it is large, but not that large, and you can always get a first model at lower resolution, but you have it. And starting from a model, then you can do something with our approach, like this HEMNA, that will estimate you all these parameters. So in this case, normal amplitudes, but maybe we search later how to do this for vectors. And then also it will estimate you rotations. And sorry?
No, it's just a preparation.
I don't know, something changed. So it will estimate you all the parameters, and then we can, with our deep learning, generalize, and then you can, let's say, predict all these parameters for a large set of images and obtain new conformational states, kind of from scratch.
Okay, okay. So thank you very much.
Thanks. Yeah.
Just time to switch the conclusion.
Okay, so I can go.
Maybe you can continue this discussion at some coffee break tomorrow, because we have to close now. Okay. This symposium, sorry. So thanks a lot again for the talk.
Thank you.
And so to keep it brief, let's conclude in just a few minutes this symposium on integrative structural modeling in the era of big data and artificial intelligence. So of course we want to thanks again very warmly all for speakers for those very nice talks and very enlightening, and I think it gave a very good view of the state of the art of the field and what is coming next. Also, we thanks again our sponsors, the Groupe de Graphisme and Modélisation Moléculaire, and we thanks of course also attendees of this symposium. You have been up to around 60 participants, which I think we can consider as a great success. And so we thank you for your attention and also for the nice questions that we had. And before you all leave, we would like to take the opportunity to remind you of the upcoming events in structural modeling and in the French community. So first, at the very beginning of August, a workshop is organized in Marseille and online to continue the discussions around the new directions of artificial intelligence in structural biology. And this is organized, among others, by Sergei and Hélène, who are with us today. So thanks a lot for this nice initiative. And then end of September, you have the biannual Congress of the GGMM, which is coupled this year with one of the French Society of Chemoinformatics and will be held in Lille and online. And finally, in November, you have the annual session of the Winter School AlgoSB, which will stay in the same area as today, because it will deal with machine learning methods to analyze and predict protein structures, dynamics, and function. So with this, I said I would be very brief. We wish all the attendees and the speakers and organizers again a nice evening. And we meet you tomorrow for the second Jobim session on structural bioinformatics. So thanks a lot, everyone. And yeah, again, have a nice evening.